about tonight. And I know that you are excited as well. How to live your best, not just any kind of life, your best life for God, Hupotasso. So I hope you are ready to learn. And as we always do with every single broadcast, I want you to tell somebody that we are live. I want you to share this broadcast because somebody, for all you know, this broadcast is going to cause one person in your contact list or five people or even 10 to give their lives to Christ. Amen. Somebody who's going to be scrolling maybe on Facebook will come across your post, and guess what? They're listening and they will change their life for the better. So it's very important to share the broadcast. It's very important to tell others about it. It's important for you to tell every Tom, Dick, and Harry that we are live. Where's your Nene? What about Ray Ray? Have you told them about the broadcast today? Please do tell them that we are live and church is about to happen. You know, this is so amazing because we get to delve into the Word of God. We get to decipher the codes that are written in the Word of God for our sakes, for our benefit. So it's very important for us to get into this word and study it. If we can have it every day, then let's have it every day. It's so important. Hallelujah. So I have in front of me people who are watching on Atomgram. I also have YouTube, and I can see people are joining. Do share the broadcast. Do tell people we are live. God is about to change your life for the better. And our man of God, Prophet Angel, said something that is so, so significant for us at this point in time. He said this is a season of spiritual growth. Right now is our time to grow spiritually more than ever before. We are going to grow, and we are growing. And I know I'm speaking for a lot of people when I say during this lockdown we have grown exponentially, so mightily grew the Word of God in our spirits that it is prevailing. So it has been amazing. And I'm usually behind the scenes seeing your comments and your questions. And I know a lot of people usually write saying, I wish this lockdown could continue because we are learning so much. So we don't want lockdown to continue because we don't get to be in church. But I do catch the drift of what you're trying to say. So we have been growing. We have been getting so much into the Word. So much has been said during these past 7 or 8 weeks. And we are so much better than when we went into lockdown. So tonight is going to be another night of learning. It's going to be another night of revelation. It's going to be another night of spiritually growing. And I am so excited. And I was just saying to the Lord, God, I just want to know more of you. Just this morning when I was praying, I said, I just want more of you. That's all I want. That's my heart's desire. I just want to grow. What is it that you want me to learn? I'm ready to learn it. I am like a baby. I don't know anything. Let me just start from scratch. I don't have any information. I'm not going to claim to be so high and mighty. I'm just a baby and I want to learn. That's what I was telling the Lord this morning. And I pray the same for every person who is watching me right now. Just be like a child. Even the Bible says, unless you are like the child, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. You will not understand it. You will not fully comprehend it. Imagine, telling your people you are the Almighty God, and you're telling your people have faith, believe in things that are not as if they were, or in other words, believe things that don't exist as if they do. It sounds so crazy to people who are intelligent, people who went to university, we went to school, people have PhDs, people have master's degrees, and the Almighty God is telling you to believe things that don't exist as if they do exist. And when you do, they exist. You know, it's mind-boggling for the one who thinks they are wise. But if you are like a child, oh, hallelujah. If you are like a child, you will be so quick to believe it. You won't question it. You will say, God, if you said it, I believe it, and I am putting it into action. So be like a child. Just be ready to learn. You know, some people always say when Prophet puts a title and he says, this is what we're going to be talking about, or if he says we're talking about faith, some people will not join that broadcast because they think they already know what faith is. They simply won't join it. If we say it's a prayer session, you say, oh, well, I prayed last night. I prayed in the morning. It's okay. I've done enough already. You see, when you are like a child, whatever is said, You quickly take it, you believe it, you run with it. And that's the kind of spirit that will inherit the kingdom. So tell me, who is here? Who is here? I can see some people are joining right here on Atomgram. People are really with me tonight. So that's a very good thing. Tell me, what's happening?
On YouTube, we have Vivian Taylor watching from USA, Ohio. Emmanuel
Welcome,
Mazer,
Vivian.
From Ghana. Marianne Constantine from London. Junietta watching. She says, I love you, prophetess. You're looking awesome. We have from Germany, Mrs. M connecting, and Innocent also watching from Tanzania. Many people are joining.
Wow, Tanzania is in the house. Welcome.
And
welcome.
On Atomgram, we've got Reta, who's watching from Hyderabad, India. Uh-huh. We've got Bibi Junior, who's in Namibia. And we also have Vimbai, who's watching from Zimbabwe.
She's watching from Zimbabwe. Wow, that's amazing. And remember, guys, we are also on Roku TV. Right now, we are live on Roku TV. So not only are you watching us here on YouTube, you could see the people who are allowed to comment, because that's not all the people that are watching. Those are the ones who managed to get into the platform and can comment on the platform. We have people who are watching on Facebook. We have Atomgram. We also have our Sky TV channel 596. Everybody in the whole of the United Kingdom, a potential of 70 million people are watching us right now in the whole of the United Kingdom. That's our potential audience. And then we have Miracle TV. The whole of Africa, we have the Middle East that is being covered. We have some parts of Europe that are being covered just by Miracle TV alone. So let's not underestimate what is happening whenever we have these live broadcasts. And then we have the Good News TV app. We also have Atomgram. People are watching right now on Atomgram. We also now have Roku TV. So people are watching us on that platform in the USA. They are watching in the Middle East. They are watching in Asia. They're watching. So many people are connected right now. So don't underestimate the power of technology. And we are using it for the kingdom. That's what it was meant for. So I am very excited to see people joining. Tell me a few more people that are joining.
Savan Sabu on YouTube. Greetings from Kerala. Fernandez from UK. Cherry Gunari from New York.
Wow,
Daliso
awesome.
Lungu is watching from Lusaka, Zambia. Ranji
Oh, from Lusaka?
Yes, Lusaka, Zambia, Spirit Embassy. Mm-hmm. And Ranjiwe is watching from Sri Lanka. Faith Njeri is watching from Kenya. Janet
watching
from Namibia. So many people are joining in right now.
That is awesome. Thank you so much for joining.
On Atomgram, we also have loads of people tuning in right now. We've got Gilead, who's watching from South Africa. Mm-hmm. We've got Lysania, who's watching from Oxfordshire. We've got Glijui, who's watching from Ghana. We also have Beatrice, who's watching from Michigan, the USA.
All right. Welcome, Beatrice from Michigan. Thank you so much for joining. Thank you, everybody, for joining this broadcast. And before we get into the word for today, I'm not going to take too much of your time. But before we get into it, I just want you to raise your hands wherever you're watching me from. I want you to just raise your hands so that we can pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I pray that this broadcast will be a defining moment for somebody who is watching me tonight. I pray in the name of Jesus that the same anointing that is upon your prophet, the same unction that is upon your prophet, be the same unction that is here, the same unction that is with your people who are watching. Let healing take place even as your word is being spoken tonight. Let breakthroughs take place as your word is being spoken of. Let miracles happen as your word is being taught tonight. I pray for every person watching that their lives will never be the same again. And your servants say, this is our season for growing spiritually. Therefore, we know that tonight is yet another meal that will help us to grow. It will help our spirits to be healthy. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Hallelujah. Yeah. Glory be to the Most High God. So I want to get into this right away. Hupotasso. I want to get into it straight away so that we can finish early. But I know for a fact that you will learn something you have never learned before. And if you knew it before, then it's time to double up on it. Whenever you hear the word of God, even if we talk about faith and we say this is what faith is, it means you need to double up on it. Get into this faith thing and be better at it than ever before. So how to live your best for God. So I want to take you to the book of James. Let's go to James chapter 4. The book of James chapter number 4. And if you don't have a Bible, then I'm not sure what kind of Christian you are, because if you have WhatsApp on your phone as an app, and you have Atomgram, and you also have YouTube on your phone, then you definitely can have the Bible app as well. Okay, so are you there? James chapter 4. Let's start reading from verse 1. Let's read from verse 1.
Yes, Prophetess. James 4, verse 1. Mm-hmm. From whence come was...
I want you to listen very carefully, all right? Listen very, very carefully. Just to give you a bit of a background, James is addressing the 12 tribes. He's writing. He says, I'm writing to the 12 tribes that are scattered out there. He's talking to Christians. He's talking to believers. People who already know the Lord, all right? So that's definitely for you, okay? So continue from verse 1.
James 4, verse 1. Mm-hmm. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Mm-hmm. Come they not hence, even of your lusts that war in your members?
Uh-huh.
Verse 2.
So he's saying, where are all these fights coming from? There's so much strife. So much. In fact, I like the Amplified version. Let me just read from the Amplified version so that you catch it. It says, what leads to strife, discord and feuds? And how do quarrels, conflicts, fightings originate among you? How on earth is this happening? Do they not arise from your sensual desires that are ever warring in your bodily members? You are jealous and covet what others have, and your desires go unfulfilled. You cannot get enough. You always want some more. Admiring what that one has. You are admiring what that one has. Envy. Hey. And then he says, you become murderers. To hate is to murder as far as your hearts are concerned. You burn with envy and anger and are not able to contain gratification, the contentment, and the happiness that you seek. So you fight and war. You do not have because you do not ask. So in other words, these people were resorting to the world system. They were fighting all the time, bickering all the time. They were jealous. They were envious. They were jealousing each other. They were gossiping. They were doing all the crazy things. And they were working with the world system. That's why he says here, you don't have because you don't ask. The reason why you don't have is because you don't ask. It's not because you need to do it yourself, but you are not asking the right things when you pray. So verse 3 says, or you do ask God for them, and yet you fail to receive them. Because you don't understand the word, you fail to receive them. And when you fail to receive them, you start blaming the church. You start blaming the pastor. You start blaming somebody in the church. Well, this is happening because somebody's giving me too much grief. Or the church I'm in is not so good. All right? He says, and yet you fail to receive. You are the one who is failing to receive. Because you ask with the wrong purpose and evil, selfish motives. Your intention is, when you get what you desire, to spend it in sensual pleasures. Do you see the level of people that James was talking to? I hope you find yourself somewhere in these scriptures tonight. How to live your best for God. These people were clearly not living their best for God. So he says, you are like unfaithful wives, having illicit love affairs with the world. Do you see what I was saying? They were so much into the world system. The government has to help me this way. This is how it usually works for me to succeed in my life. Somebody has to help me in politics, or somebody has to help me there, or a relative of mine has to help me here, or this has to happen. An entitlement. They were entitled. And so he likens them to unfaithful wives. You have love affairs with the world, and you break your marriage vow to God. Do you not know that being the world's friend is being God's enemy? Yeah. So whoever chooses to be a friend of the world takes his stand as an enemy of God. And then verse 5. Or do you suppose that the scripture is speaking to no purpose that says the spirit whom he has caused to dwell in us yearns over us and yearns for the spirit to be welcome with jealous love? In other words, God is saying the spirit that I've put in you, he's jealous because you are no longer being led by the spirit. You are being led by the world system. You are being led by your jealousy. You are being led by your envy. It's no longer the Holy Spirit that I placed in you. And that's another indication that he was talking to believers. Because if he was talking to people in the world, they wouldn't have the spirit of God in them. God wouldn't be saying, I am jealous. The spirit in you is jealous because he's yearning for a relationship with you. He's yearning for you to rely on him alone rather than the system of the world that you are now following. All right. Verse 6 is where I want us to get to. He says it this way, but he gives us more and more grace or power of the Holy Spirit. I'll read it first in King James. He says, but he giveth more grace. I want you to listen to this carefully because this is where we're going. He giveth more grace. How do you want to obtain more grace? All right, let's hear it. He giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resists the proud, but he gives grace unto the humble. Did you catch it? Did you catch it? He says he gives us more and more grace and amplified or power of the Holy Spirit to meet this evil tendency and all others fully. That is why he says God sets himself against the proud and haughty. So he resists the proud. Amen. He gives more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resists the proud. So if you want to grow in grace, in other words, you have to listen carefully to what I'm about to say. He does give more grace, but there are things that he doesn't like. All right? Yes, God wants you to excel. Yes, God wants you to do well. He wants you to grow in grace because remember the prophet said, when you grow in grace, you are growing in faith. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. And faith is the currency of heaven. Without faith, you cannot, there is no divine exchange. You see, when you desire a miracle, there is a payment that has to be made. And what's the payment? Faith. So faith is a currency. That's why we always say faith is a currency. So when you walk into the heavenly shop for spare parts, spare body parts, the angel who is manning that shop is going to say, right, what can I do for you today? And you say, right, angel, I have arthritis, you know, in my left leg. I need a brand new leg right now. And this is you praying while you are sitting in your home or you are in a church service. The moment you pray, the angel will say, right, one right leg coming up right away. You'll go into the warehouse, grab a right leg for you. It's that easy. That's how miracles take place. He grabs a right leg. The one that has arthritis is ready to take it away. And then he says, right, here is the leg. Now, I need the payment. Where is your faith? And if you have no faith to exchange for the brand new leg, then there is no leg coming to you. That's how faith works. Now, the Bible here is saying, in order for you to grow to that extent, to that level, where your faith is at a point where you can achieve anything, you can do anything, and you have so much grace that is flowing through your body, in your whole household, in order for you to get there, you need to listen to something that God does not like. And this is what verse 6 is all about. He says, but God gives you more grace. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the more grace. Wherefore he saith, but first, listen, God resists the proud. And this is where we're going today. God resists the proud, but gives grace unto the humble. Hey, I don't know if you guys are going to catch this today. I don't know if you're going to catch it.
BeBe Junior Angel on YouTube is saying, uh-huh. I catch it. To get more grace is to be humble. And uh-huh. Janet on Facebook is saying, thank you, Prophet and Prophetess, for making me grow in the good news. Mm-hmm. I am growing spiritually, and mm-hmm. I'm growing in my prayer life. Thank you for the blessings.
All right. That's awesome.
On Atomgram, we have a lot of people who are actually acknowledging to say, yes, mm-hmm. ma'am, faith is the currency.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Now, I want you to notice something here, because this scripture that we've just read, this is James quoting another scripture in the book of Proverbs. This is Proverbs 34. So he's quoting, he's making reference of something that was said before. Now he's talking to people who are supposed to know the scriptures because this is in Proverbs. And he's talking to people now. This is the book of James. He's talking to people who have known Christ came, he died for us, they're born again, they've received Christ. And yet the Bible tells them that God resists the one who says, I am proud. He resists the scorner. He scorns the scorner. But somebody who humbles themselves, God will always elevate. So this is where we are at. Now, I want you to look at this word right here. I want you to look at this word. Are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Are you sure? Because I want you to learn something today, all right? It's very, very important that you learn something today.
Lekota on YouTube is saying, oh, God, help me not to blame anybody in my life. May God help me not to be led by envy. Thank you, God, for giving me more grace. Love you, ma'am.
All right.
From South Africa.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. So I want you to notice that word resist. God resists the proud. Resist. The word that you are looking at there is the word antitasso. Antitasso. I want you to write it down. Antitasso. Very, very important word in the scripture. God antitassos the proud. Antitasso. Now, when you look up this word in the original rendering, we are looking at a very loaded word. This word is so loaded. In fact, I just want you to catch it. I just want you to catch it. So I want to give you an example. Do you know when, especially for those who have been in the army, you will immediately capture my analogy, or catch it, rather. Yep. So when we talk about the word antitasso, we are talking about, it's made in reference to the army. So when the army is, let's say the army is ready to march and they are all put in parade, they are all standing at attention, everybody's ready to march or to receive orders from the commander. Everybody's there. The Bible talks about one person when it talks about antitasso. It's a word that encapsulates everything that I'm describing to you right now. So it talks about one person who defects. Let's say the army is commanded, right, march forward. And then they all start marching in precision. And yet one guy, one soldier decides to march in the opposite direction. So when he starts marching in the opposite direction, the whole army stands still and they start thinking, we need to oppose this one because he has opposed the commander. That's antitasso. So it's a military term that is actually used in the army. All right? So in ancient armies, even in the Bible, when they spoke about antitasso, every soldier knew what was being talked about when they were told antitasso has happened. Because it would also refer to the whole army coming against an enemy. If there was an enemy of the nation, the entire army knew that we are coming against this particular country, or we are coming against this particular city or nation or whatever the case was at the time. So antitasso was basically the army coming against anyone who deflected against what was supposed to be, or anyone who decided to do their own thing. Anyone who decides, I can do it on my own. Anyone who decides, I don't need to be commanded. I don't need anyone above me. I don't need a commander to tell me what to do. I can do it all by myself. Remember, James is talking to people who were living their life the way they wanted to live. They knew the scriptures because it's there in the book of Proverbs, chapter 34, the exact same scripture. So James is not talking about something that he came up with, or the Holy Spirit just inspired him to say it. No, he's quoting the book of Proverbs 34 when he says, God resists the proud. God resists or scorns the scorner, as it is said in the book of Proverbs. So these people understood the word, but they decided to go against what the commander had done. They had done what is called an antitasso. So when God resists someone who has pride, what he is literally doing is turning his whole back against you. It's like the whole army of God turns against you. Do you catch the drift of what I'm saying, and the seriousness and the gravity of how bad it is for God to resist you? When things get to a point where God resists you, imagine your own maker, the one who created you, the one who says, I love you no matter what. But when it gets to a point where he says, I've tried. This time I resist. This I resist. And what does God resist? The proud. The person who calls himself proud. I don't know if you are catching it.
We have people who are catching it. Are they catching it? Atom Rem. We have Henry Maravu who's saying, yes, ma'am, you are correct. It's the emphasis on uniformity in relation to the command.
Oh, so that's somebody who knows.
Yes, he's actually
he's in the army.
Yes, he's in the army.
All right, so the whole army deliberately premeditating an attack. They know this is what we are going to do, so we are planning an attack. That's anti-tasso, resistance. Do you see the seriousness of this? My biggest prayer is for somebody to learn something tonight that they will apply. And the best thing about God's word is it is so current.
Yep.
God's word is for
Hallelujah.
It's for today. It's for now, this very second. You can't say, well, I'll start applying this once lockdown is over, and then I'm going to really start my seriousness with God. You can't say that. It says God resists the proud. He anti-tasso the proud. A whole army coming against one. And imagine how this is so organized. The army of the Lord. Just imagine the army of the Lord coming against one person who decides, I'm not going to listen to the commander. And in this case, the commander will be God. Say, I'm not listening. If God said it, I'm not going to listen. But I want you to notice something that is very profound. Nowadays in churches, we have a situation where the army of God, that is all of us, right? We are the Christian army. When one person decides to hate on God, say all kinds of bad things, guess what? Everybody follows the person who is saying the bad things. If one person has so much pride, they develop so much pride in them, they leave church, they start saying all kinds of things, guess what the rest of the army does? They start following the guy who is proud, the guy who is showing so much pride in them, the one who has something that God resists, and the church starts following. This is, it doesn't make no sense at all. God resists pride. We ought to have a situation where when a brother or a sister in church decides to not listen to the commands of God or decides to start ranting and raving about God's work, we need to resist that person. That person has to be shown, no, we do not agree with what you say against men of God. I do not agree or with anything you say on your blogs concerning men of God or the Church of Christ. I do not agree. If somebody calls you and they are in the mood, they want to talk about this, such and such a prophet, or they feel like talking about such and such a prophetess. Yeah. Did you see what she was saying? Did you see what she was wearing? Did you see what was the post about? Did you see the face? I think something is wrong. Did you see? I think Prophetess Angel these days, something is wrong. Did you see the kind of smile? Did you notice? Or did you see the way she looked at Prophet? Did the glance, the way she glanced at Prophet? I think it was a sign. She was signaling to him that she was not happy. I know, I got witnesses right now. People who just want to talk things that make no sense. Things you just feel, you are itchy. You want to scratch. I need to talk about this. I need to say. And yet, you know, it goes against what God desires. It goes against God's word. To speak against men of God goes against his word. You know what? The Lord of the harvest, he's so smart, so full of wisdom. You know what he said in his word? He knew that we were going to have a problem with a certain man of God here, a certain woman of God there. He knew that the body of Christ was going to start fighting and saying, what about that pastor? What about that woman of God? What about him? What about that one? What about that apostle? What about that prophet? He knew this was going to happen. So what does he do? He says, listen up. When it comes to my harvest, remember, I am the Lord of the harvest myself.
Come on.
Let everything grow together. The tares, the wheat, let it just all grow together.
Yeah.
The ones that are bad and the ones that are good. I, the Lord of the harvest. When it's time to harvest, I will know what to do. You see, so the Lord of the harvest got this. You don't need to help him. Let him do his thing. Let him do his thing. He's the Lord of the harvest. So when it comes to resisting the proud, God's saying, I resist, I anti-tasso the proud. We ought to be a body that stands together. When it's a government that is coming against a single man of God, we need to come against that government. We need to pray against any power, any demonic power that the devil has allowed to penetrate that government. And then we support the work of the Lord. We don't gloat, we don't laugh when something happens against a man of God or a woman of God. We don't do those things. Because when we do that, we are linking with the proud instead of anti-tasso. We have to resist the devil. Get to a point where it is you who is resisting the devil.
Yes, 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 yes.
Get to that point where you are the one who anti-tassels the devil, not the other way around. You are the deflector. You are the one who goes in the opposite direction instead of falling in line and going with the prescribed order. Order is so important, whether it's in a home, just in a normal home. I know I have so many couples watching me right now. Imagine your wife does her own thing. Her money is her own. She does her own thing. She decides, I'm going to buy this today. I'm going to do that today. I'm buying a new car. I'm buying a new house, my own house. You don't even know anything about it. And the children do their own thing. It's like haphazard. The husband is doing his own thing. Why? There's no order. There's no prescribed order. That's not how things work. Same as in church. It can be haphazard. The pastor says something. The junior pastor is saying this. Another preacher from another branch is saying this. And then there's this one. Discord all over the place. God resists that. God resists it. All right? So he anti-tassels. A whole army deliberately working against you. So God will allow certain events. You see, this is what happens when you become proud to a level where you have been told so many times that the direction you are going in, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, and you continuously go in that direction. You are being rebuked, and you even hate the fact that you are being rebuked. When someone tells you you've done this wrong, you are up in arms. When your man of God tells you you've done something wrong, you are up in arms. You may not show it physically that you are up in arms, but in your heart, you are angry, you are bitter. You know the potato we're talking about, the last sitting on your throat. How can she say that? How can my pastor tell this to me? How can my woman of God, this, I knew she wasn't a woman of God. I knew something was wrong. How can she comment about this? How can, why me? Out of all the rest of the church, why single me out? I know some of you have said that. That's pride working in you, brother. That's pride working in you, sister. When you are at a level where no one can tell you anything and people are scared to tell you, they fear if we tell him, he's going to leave the church. If we tell this lady about this, she's going to leave the church. She's the only worship leader we have. Or she's the only person who is helping in this department. They are scared to tell you. Then you know there is so much pride in you and God resists you. God gets to a point where a whole army is working against you. Now, when a person has that continual, we're talking about how to live the best for God. So I want you to stay with me. So when you go on continuously, you are living your life the way you want to live it, the way James is talking to the people, James is describing in his book to these people, to the 12 tribes, he's describing the kind of things that were happening. They were jealous of each other. They were fighting each other. They were following the world system. They were no longer following God's system. Sounds more like what is happening right now, where whatever the world says, that's where everybody follows. The rights are now, women's rights are now thrown beyond proportion. It's now extreme. It's not even aligning with the word of God anymore. Even gay rights and all kinds of other rights, this the right to live the way you want, too many rights, too much entitlement. And one guy came out recently and he said, wow, since you've allowed gays, if a man feels like he's a woman and if a woman feels like she is a man and you've allowed them, well, I'm a teddy bear. So this is how I live. And he was wearing a teddy bear costume. And he was walking around the town looking like a teddy bear. And people said he wanted to walk into his workplace wearing a teddy bear outfit. And his boss said, hang on, this is a corporate office. We don't do things this way. And he said, no, you have gays working here. You have transgenders, lesbians working here. I'm a teddy bear, so let me be. And guess what? The issue went to court because this guy took his employer to court. He said, he's not affording me my rights. And they had to go to court. Imagine a whole judge sitting there to listen to a man who wants to be a teddy bear, or who feels, I'm a teddy, I was created to be a teddy bear, but I'm trapped in a human body. Imagine this. You see, it's a world that is now just following the world system, a body of Christ that is following the world system. If the world system says it, I'm just going to follow it. You're just conforming to the world. That's exactly what was happening at the time of this writing. And then God says, I resist these people who are so full of pride. I resist them. These are the things that God hates. I anti-tasso them. I don't know whether they are catching it. Are you getting it before I carry on?
Alice Schumper on Facebook is saying, I refuse to have God turn against me. I refuse to be proud. And thank you, Mom. And also, Una Duze saying, God's army against me, no ways. I'm getting in line right now. I can't afford that.
On Atomgram,
Getting in line.
On Atomgram, we have Reverend Titus Young who's saying, we are watching live from USA via Roku. This word is good. This word is for now. Thank
wow,
you,
Mom. Watching via Roku TV. Wow, that's amazing. Now, yes, tell me.
Kola by saying,
yes.
Oh, Mom, I'm
I can see a lot of people commenting here. What is she saying?
She's saying, I'm watching you from SA, and I just love this preaching. I come against the spirit of pride in me.
Hallelujah.
On
so
Atomgram,
God,
we have Davina Clark who's saying, I can be like that sometimes. Something I definitely need to work on.
Wow, that's good. So she's saying, I can be like that sometimes.
Yes.
All right. So I'm very glad that you are doing a little bit of introspection. Introspection is always looking at yourself. You don't look at what others are doing. You look at yourself and then you position yourself in God's word and you say, how do I fix myself? This is where I find myself and this is the solution and this is how I'm going to proceed. So that's a very good thing. So what happens is God will simply allow certain events to happen around you until you bow. Because everybody has to bow their knee to the Lord, no matter who you are. The Bible says every knee shall bow. Every tongue shall confess. So it doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter how high and mighty you are. One day you have to bow. You see, but it would be better if you willingly do it. God prefers for us to willingly listen to what he says and we remove pride from ourselves. So he will allow certain things to happen around you. Then you start wondering, why is this happening in my life? I wonder why this is happening. And then things are not moving according to plan. And you start thinking, what is it that I've done wrong? I thought I'm going to church, okay. I'm speaking in tongues. I sowed a seed even yesterday, but this thing is happening. And why is my life not progressing? That is a clear indication that there is no grace that is growing in you. And this could be one of the reasons, because remember, the scripture says, God gives you more grace, more and more grace on top of more grace. It's just flowing in your life. Grace for you to succeed in your homes, in your health, in everything that you do, in everything that you touch. So if there is no presence of success, if there is no presence of progress in your life, could it be that there is pride that is hidden somewhere in you? Could it be that you are resisting God somewhere? You are not aligning to God's word somewhere. Where the rest of God's army is marching forward, you have sort of deviated and you are marching in a different direction. Could it be that you are no longer aligning with God's word concerning your life? Because there is a reason why things are not moving. There is a reason why anything you try to start this business today, before you know it, it just fizzles out. One minute, people are interested in your products. Everybody wants to, we want to use your products. Next thing you know, they're not interested. And yet, on the other hand, you see other brothers and sisters in church, their businesses are like evergreen. Every day, they are just clapping hands and praising the Lord that my business is moving, this is moving. And in some cases, you even have the exact same business, but it'll work for others and it won't work for you. Could it be that you are harboring pride on the inside of you? Pride is very subtle. In some cases, very, very subtle. And it's very hard to diagnose yourself with pride. Sometimes it takes somebody to tell you, this is pride. One time, Prophet said something that was so crazy because I was still growing as well at the time. So he says, this was when we were still starting out in ministry. And he said something. He said, today, I want you to prophesy to these people, and this is what we are going to be doing, minister to a few people. And I really didn't want to do it out of fear. I said, no, I'm too scared to do it. These early days of the ministry, I think during the first year, he said, I'm too scared to do it. And then he said, that's pride. I was shocked. I said, how can it be pride? I'm just scared, that's all. He said, no, it's pride. Because when you are scared to embarrass who? Yourself. When you are scared to embarrass yourself, it means you have pride. That's exactly what it means. So pride can come in a shape or format that you were not expecting until somebody actually highlights it for you and says, brother, that's pride. And then you have to work on it. You see, so something that you could think, oh, I'm so scared. If somebody says, why don't you do this, start this business, I'm so scared. You have too much pride because you don't want Shakwita and Shanene to say, hey, did you see that one? Did you see how she failed? Or did you see how she fell? She fell. So now look at what is happening. People are laughing at me because I fell. It's pride. When you do God's work, especially when you have been commanded by your commander can be your man of God. It can be your woman of God. And it can be God himself. When your commander tells you, align in this direction, you follow what the commander says. Amen. The moment you start putting yourself and saying, I'm so scared. Thank you so much for the opportunity, but I'm scared. I'm going to fail. And it's just, no, I'm scared. Pride. And God resists you. That could be the reason why things are not moving for you. And there is a very powerful saying in the world. It said, pride comes before what? A fall. Pride comes before a fall. So a message like this is very timely. Now, this is how it works. When, I'll try and explain. When a person is just a normal person, let's say just normal people, people created by God, they are at this level. This is level zero. Everybody's in the same plane, same opportunities. You're just normal people. You're just experiencing the same sunshine, same rain, same wind that is blowing. Whatever the case is, you're not born again. We're all just people in the world. That's level zero. When you decide to be born again, to give your life to Christ, God then elevates you. He takes you from the madding crowd, where everybody else is, the masses, the world. He takes you out of the world, and then he uplifts you. Now you are on this level here. You are now on level one, a level where God has elevated you. He has brought you here. This is what he has given you. This is who you are now. Now that you are in Christ and you gave your life to him, he gave you a certain position and he elevated you. And this is where you are. You are no longer at the bottom. You are now growing. You are now here. Pride then sets in when you skip the level that God has given you, where you're supposed to be. Pride comes in when you give yourself another higher one. Where nobody gave you this position, you are supposed to be here where God put you, but you are now so high and mighty in your head. No one can say nothing to you because you are here. You've left your prescribed order. You've left where God put you, where you were supposed to be, where he raised you to be. Your own bar, your own level, your own lane. And you have skipped, you say, this lane is boring. I need to be in that lane, in the opposite lane. And then you exalt yourself above what God said you are. You start thinking thoughts. Imagine what Prophet was talking about as well when he was saying the devil himself. He started thinking some serious thoughts in his head, crazy thoughts in his head. He said, I will rise above all the stars. And when he was talking about stars, he was talking about the angels. All the seraphims, he was a cherubim. And seraphims are above, in hierarchy, the seraphims are above the cherubims in hierarchy. And yet he said, I will rise above all the stars. In other words, I don't care which angel is above me. I don't care about anything. I'll rise above everyone, all the stars, and I'll be number one. And that was pride. The very thing that God resists. The very thing he anti-tasso. He would rather have a whole army against somebody who has pride. The very thing. That's exactly what the devil had. Pride was found in him. To a point where you leave the position that God has given you. And then you elevate yourself to one that nobody gave you. Who said you should be doing what you're doing? Who said you should be telling others what to do? You command this person, you command that one. Who raised you to that position? And some of you raise yourselves there, and yet the level that God had put you was diaper level. You were wearing your Huggies and your Pampers. And God put you there deliberately because he knows you are not yet good enough to be here. So for now, I'm going to put you right here, and you learn, you grow in grace, and then I'll start elevating you even more. So when you elevate yourself beyond what God has given you, you get to this position and you'll embarrass yourself, because that's when pampers usually fall off. You are way out of your league. You are way out of your league. God resists that. So always understand. Always understand. Where am I? And you see, this level that God brings you to, from here when you were just a random person in the world to the level that God puts you, you even have to be a little lower than the position that God gave you. You know that I'm a mighty man of God. I am a mighty woman of God. God is using me mightily. Still, God says, now, be humble. Let's read it. Let's finish reading this James scripture. What does it say? James verse 6. It says, but he gives more grace, right? Mm-hmm. Wherefore, he said, God resists the proud, right? Mm-hmm. But he gives grace unto the humble, mm-hmm. right? He gives grace unto the humble. So when you know your position that God has given you, you know, this is my position. This is where I was. This is where God brought me to. Still, I know God has given me so much grace to lead God's people. He has given me so much grace to have money in my life. Maybe you are the richest one in your family. You are the one who is doing well in your family. Or God has given you a superior intellect. Maybe you are the smartest. You are very clever. You've got a degree. You've got master's, PhD in your family. God still says, yes, I'm the one who gave you that position. But still, I want you to lower yourself. Still, I want you to put yourself a little bit under. You know you can fill stadiums. You know you can fill a hall. If you say tomorrow after this lockdown, I'm going to be preaching in such and such a place, people will come. All of them, oh, they will fill the place. No problem. But God says, the position I gave you, still understand. Humility. Humble yourself. Lower yourself. So he says, but grace is what I will give to the person who humbles themselves. Hallelujah. This is amazing, because humility is such a rare commodity these days. And I want you to listen very carefully to where we are going to be going. I'm about to finish, so I want you to listen very carefully. He says, the one who is humble is the one I will give grace. Are they catching it?
They are catching it, Mom.
I can see some questions and things. Are they catching it here?
They are on YouTube. Uh-huh. Sandra is saying, this is my day. Mm-hmm. This message, I'm being delivered from the spirit of pride and anger in the mighty name of Jesus.
All right.
And Blessing Chuari is saying, well, I've learned something new and great. I repent from this pride. This is deep. Thank you, Mom.
All right.
And Atom Graham, Henry Maravu is back again. He's saying, wow. Mm-hmm. When you are scared in embarrassing yourself, it is pride. I'm listening, prophetess. I am delivered of this pride disguising itself in fear, thinking I cannot do it.
And Prosper Joshua is
very good
saying,
point.
This is the reason why Satan was sent out of heaven. Pride is very deadly, more than COVID, because it pulls down a person who is pursuing. It's risky being so proud at a young age. You are changing a generation.
Ah, I like that. I like it. I like it. Right. So if you look at that word in verse number 6, where it says God resists the proud but gives grace unto the humble, the word humble there is the word taipenos. Taipenos. It talks about somebody who was formerly arrogant. So it's not something that just happened. It's somebody who was formerly arrogant. Oh, Jesus. Now, humility is not something that you are born with. You are not born with humility. In fact, what people have when they are born is more pride than anything. Because you'll find pride even in a small little kid, that this kid has too much pride. You've seen it, right? You see a small little guy, and he doesn't even know how to speak well to his elders. Doesn't respect anyone. And you ask, how old are you? 6. Ah, a 6-year-old, and they have so much pride in them. But you see, somebody who has humility. Humility, oh my God, it's something that you have to put on. I want to show you this scripture. Let me show you this verse. I need to show you this verse. Go to Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. I want you to go to Colossians. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Very, very important.
Yes, Colossians 3, verse 12.
Yeah, what does it say?
Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved.
What does it say?
Put on, therefore.
Put on, therefore. All right, carry on.
As the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind.
What? What does it say? Humbleness of mind. You see, so what this is essentially telling you, it's saying put on. Do you know what to put on is? If you look at the original rendering, that statement put on means as if you are wearing clothes. You take a shirt and you put it on. You literally get dressed. So humility is not something that just appears in your spirit that, oh, humility is so full in my spirit today. Today, I just feel more. God gave me too much humility today. So I feel like, I just feel like I'm so humble today. There is no such thing. Wow. Humility is something you physically put it on. Wow. Take the shirt. You wake up in the morning, go get your humility shirt. Put it on and to carry on with your day. That's exactly what the Bible is saying right there.
Wow.
Do you see it? So you put on humility. It doesn't come naturally. You put it on. That's why I was saying the level that God puts you, when God elevates you from the time that you were born again, he elevated you, gave you a certain position in society, in the kingdom. You were given a certain position. You need to lower yourself still. From where God put you, lower yourself. You still need to tell yourself, I am humble. This is who I am. I lower myself. Have you ever seen, maybe there was a time, maybe you're a young minister, there was a time when you were asked to share in church. Oh, please, brother, come up and share this word. Hey, you felt the honor. You said, wow, I'm so honored. This is too much. I mean, this platform and this is too much for me. You were honored. You were shaking just to be given a chance to speak in church in front of everyone. And then came a time when you were not asked to share. Now you have grown, right? You were not asked. No one is calling you for a spot. And you said, but these people, they don't give me a chance to speak anymore. These days, I don't even get to say anything in church. I don't even get to share to anyone. I have some revelations. I need to teach these people. I'm seeing the pastors are being, this pastor, he came even before me. He joined this church after I came. But they are already sending him on a mission. They are already giving him this position. But I am the one who came first before everyone else. Pride has already set in.
That's true.
You see, pride comes in ways that if you are not careful, you will live your life in so much pride. Things will never move for you. Circumstances are happening around you because remember, God will cause things to happen around you, hoping that your noodle, one day, your brain will start thinking, why are all these calamities happening around me? This happened, I started the business, it fell. I tried to have this relationship with this person, it fell. I tried to do this, it fell. I tried to do this one, it fell. Everything around you is falling to the ground. This is now time that you start thinking, why is this happening? In church, people respected you before, but all of a sudden, people don't even know you exist anymore. People have even forgotten you. You used to be a strong member of the church, but now nobody even blinks in your direction. Why? You grew in pride. Something in you started growing. Your pride started growing. You wanted to, you felt like you can do things on your own. You felt like you had a better way of doing certain things. And by so doing, you left the prescribed order and you deviated from the plan that God had for you. And you went west while the rest of the army was marching north. You deviated from God's plan concerning your life. Put on humility. It's something you must learn. It's something you must practice. When you get to a wedding, in fact, I witnessed one person, we were invited to this very prestigious wedding some years ago. And imagine, we get there and everybody had a place they were given. You sit here, you sit there. One guy decided to go to the high table. We saw him sitting at the high table. Well, we don't know who's who at the wedding. So we just thought, well, maybe he's supposed to be there. And he was just sat there. And he was even waving at some people while he was at the high table. You know, the high table is the one that is usually there. It looks nicer than everywhere else. And he's waving at people in the crowd, waving while he was there at the high table, waving, waving. And then the wedding party arrived. And guess what? He was told, brother, this is not where you were supposed to sit. Your place is over there at the back. That's where you were supposed to sit. Now imagine that. Now, do you guys know that is actually a scripture in the Bible? The Bible says, don't rush to sit at the high table, just in case that's not where you were positioned. Rather start from the back. And then they will call you and say, no, why are you sitting here? This is not for you. Come, please, come to the high table. You don't start from here. Start from there, start from the bottom. Some of you are so desperate to be seen. You are so desperate to be heard. You want to preach your own revelation. You want to go against what is in the vision in your church family. Your man of God has told you, this is what we do. You want to preach Ash Wednesday. This happened in our church some years ago. Somebody was preaching Ash Wednesday, and they even brought some palms and everything. Something we are clueless about. Imagine Palm Sunday. He learned it from the Catholic Church where he was coming from, and he said, this one is a big revelation. They will see me on Sunday. And he brought his palms, sharing them with the people. Here, this is your palm. And that's a big mistake, because the people he was sharing with are part of the army. They should have realized this is what God resists. This is anti-Paso. This is not what we do. He's going out of the order. Therefore, we resist this person because he's going against what we were taught. That is who you are when you're in the body of Christ. When you see someone deviate, you don't follow them. You resist them and you tell them, come back to the order. That's how it works. I don't know. Are they catching it?
Yes, Mom, they are catching it.
Are they catching it?
Michelle Sandile saying, spirit-filled message, grace, great wisdom right there. I feel I've been lacking on this field without realizing. Thank you, Mom. Thank you so much.
And I want you to go to Proverbs 26, verse 12, very quickly. Proverbs 26. Yes, I'm catching it. Good. It's good to see
God
that you are catching
it. Saying, oh, yes, I'm hearing you, Mom. Humility doesn't come naturally. I have to put it on and I have to clothe myself with it.
Yes.
Thank you.
Exactly. What does it say?
Proverbs
26, 12. Verse 12. Yes.
Seest thou a man wise in his own conceit? There is more hope for a fool than of him.
Wow. Did you hear that? It says, do you see a person wise in their own eyes? Proverbs 26, verse 12. Someone who says they are wise, in whose eyes? Not in our eyes. We did not say you were wise. You said it to yourself. The Bible says there is more hope for a fool than for a person who says they are wise in their own eyes. They are drunk on their own juice. You sing a song and you say, I am the best artist. Wow, nobody has heard me. My voice is so angelic, even the angels admire me. Who said that? Did you ask us for our opinion? Who did you ask for that when you came to that conclusion? It says a fool is even better. A fool is better than a person who says, I am. In their own eyes, you think you are smart. You think you are clever. Pride is in you. Somebody who has pride, a fool is better. That's what God is saying. A fool. A real, real fool. I want it to sink in for a little bit. A fool is better than you. If you carry pride in your heart, if you are someone who always, everything you know how to do it, we can't even advise you. We tell you do this. I know. There's nothing I don't like. And a person who says, I know. Even if we tell you about the pyramids of Giza, I know. So the pyramid, let me tell you, the pyramid is like this. Were you there? I was there myself. Let me explain. No, you see, the pyramids, they work this way. And then you don't have anything to add. Somebody, a know-it-all, someone who thinks they know absolutely everything. You can't teach them anything. Their spirit is not broken. It's not a contrite spirit. You can't say anything. Yeah. What you're saying, I know. I heard it. Actually, it's good you're mentioning it. I heard it. It's like this. And they try to explain. And usually when they try to explain it, they are so lost in their explanation.
Come on.
That is pride. We're talking about how to live the best, right? You want to live the best life for God? This is the best way to do it. Put on humility, because God resists people who have pride. So you put it on. Let it be a part of you. Don't be like a fool. In fact, a fool is better according to the Bible. Don't be worse than a fool by saying, I am wise. In your own eyes, I am wise. And it's so funny how the Bible says, in their own eyes. Not in the eyes of anybody. In their own eyes, they think they are smart. Be somebody that can be told. Someone can actually give you a bit of advice here and there. Oh, brother, why don't you try doing things this way? Are you sure this is the right plan of action? Did you look at this viewpoint? Or you are getting lost here. Why don't you come back? Do things this way. But oh no, you don't want to be told. Yeah. No. He's a junior. This person is a junior to me. Junior has no business telling me. I'm a senior in the choir, so juniors, no. And especially this one, she joined last week. So me, I've been here 5 years. What business does she have telling me, a senior in this choir, what to do? That's pride. That's pride. Let's go to where we need to get to. Amen. Let's go where we need to get to.
Abigail Stephen on YouTube is saying, thank you so much for this teaching, ma'am. Mm-hmm. I thought I am humble until I heard you. This is powerful. I anti-tasso pride right away. I'm blessed beyond measure.
Glory be to God. That's good. James was literally appealing for these people to realign with what God had told them. He was telling them, align yourselves with the word. Come back. You've already gone in this direction. Where are you going? Who said you should be doing the things? And if you look at even the tone, you know you can tell a tone when these things are written in the Bible. It says, from whence come wars and fightings among you? You can tell the tone that James was using. He was really upset. He said, where are these things coming from again? I thought we had preached the word to you. We thought you already know these things. Don't you know that God resists the proud? Don't you know these things are written? You saw Christ. You saw how Christ lived. You ought to be Christ-like. Now where is all this coming from? You are now know-it-alls. You think you can do things by yourself. You now think you know everything. You don't need anybody to teach you. And then this is what he says. Let's go to verse 7 of the same chapter. And this is where Hupotasso comes in. All right? We are about to finish. All right, let's go. James, we're still in James chapter 4. Let's read it. Verse 7.
James 4, verse 7.
Yes.
Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Mm-hmm. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you.
Submit yourselves. I want you to read it again. Read it again very slowly.
Submit yourselves, therefore, to God.
Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. That word submit is the word hupotasso. That's the title of this message today. Wow. Submit hupotasso.
Wow.
Submit yourself.
Wow.
Submit yourself. Uh-huh. And then what is it? To God.
Mm-hmm. Resist the devil.
Resist the devil.
And he will flee from you.
And he will flee from you. So in other words, if you are looking for a formula to chase the devil out of your life, you need to understand what it means to hupotasso, to submit yourself to God. You know, a lot of people always quote this scripture. Verse 7, in fact, they don't even start where it says submit yourself. They say, resist the devil, he will flee. Resist the devil, he will flee. Resist him right now. Pray, pray, pray. Resist him, resist him. In prayer, that prayer is useless, brother. You cannot pray to resist the devil. According to this scripture right here, there is a formula that God has already prescribed. If you want the devil to flee from you, if you want the devil to not mess up your business or be all up in your business, in your kids, in your family, in your career, everywhere, the formula is submit yourself, therefore, to God. Simple and straightforward. Hupotasso. Hupo simply means to place yourself under. That's what it means. So remember what I was saying, when God elevates you and you put yourself under, you are submitting yourself under God. You're saying, I choose it myself. I put myself down. And tasso is exactly the same word. Do you remember when we were talking about anti-tasso? Do you guys remember? Resist. When I was saying the word resist means anti-tasso. Remember when the army is marching and is going against somebody? All right. So that's the exact same word used above. The deliberate attempt by the army to attack an enemy, okay? Or the deliberate arrangements. They arrange, this is what we are going to do tomorrow. We are attacking this country, and this is how we are going to achieve whatever we want to achieve. This is how we are going to win this battle. So tasso, so hupotasso, you are under, you have positioned yourself under willfully. Willfully, you have placed yourself under. That's what hupotasso means. Willfully, you say, God, I submit to you. I submit to you. What is it that you want me to do? In this dispensation, in this generation, what is it that you want me to do? You are humble. What is it that you want me to say to your people? What is it that you want me to do? Okay, so this is what our man of God has said. Because everything that God is going to tell you, remember, God is a God of order. Everything he's going to tell you is aligned. It's coming through your church family. It's coming through your man of God. It's coming through your woman of God. So whatever your man of God has told you, that's your answer. Say, okay, God, I know my man of God was talking about us doing this, and he said we should do this. That's exactly what I'm going to do. Now I know the will of God concerning my life through my voice, through my man of God, and that's exactly what I'm going to do. That's submitting yourself under God. And if God says, I resist the proud, then you are telling yourself, I'm removing all pride for myself. I'm putting on humility instead. So I remove pride for myself. Any inch, any little tiny speck of pride that I have. And some of you actually know that you have pride. It's not even a case where the pride is subtle or it's hidden. You know it yourself. I have pride. You even pride in yourself in the fact that you have pride. Say, me, I'm very proud. I'm a proud man. I don't do those things. I'm a proud woman. No one talk to me like that. I'm a proud woman. Don't touch me. Don't play with me. I'm a proud woman. Sounds good, but guess what? God resists that. That's not confidence. It's pride. That's just pride. You are untouchable. Your family members are even scared of you. Said this one, hey, some of you will even say, my family knows me. Try, ask my family. They let them try me. They know me from growing up. They know me. That's your motto. These are the things that come out of your mouth. You are a Christian. You call yourself a Christian, and yet you can utter the same words. Wow. Ask my family members. They know me very well. Don't play with me. One word, you utter one word, I will finish you. I will finish you. This is what some of you say. That's what you are like. Your family, yes, you are right. Your family knows you. They know you are evil. They know when we start up with this one, it won't finish. It's better to just stay away. And you think they are scared of you. They are not scared of you. They know you are worse than a fool. They know what kind of character you have. They know you have too much pride. No one can even touch you. And you even say, I'm untouchable. No one can touch me in our family. They know me very well in my family. Try, ask my brothers. Ask my sisters. Just say my name. Say my name there. They will tell you. At my workplace, just mention the name. They're even scared of me there. And you think, you actually think that that is a good thing? You actually think that being hard like that makes you somebody in society? Threatening people, glorying, you are happy when people feel threatened by you? God resists you. He resists you because of the pride that is in you. No wonder things don't move for you. No wonder you try to start a small business, simple little business that really should give you money. It never works. Why? You have too much pride in you. You have gone against the prescribed order by thinking your hardness is what makes you someone. This is what James was saying. He was saying, who taught you these things? Why are you constantly fighting? You are always up in arms with each other, always up in arms with your family members. Nothing good comes out of your mouth. You are so jealous, and your jealousy has driven you so much to an extent that you cannot see clearly. All you see is green. You are no longer green with envy yourself. Everything is green everywhere. You are jealous of anything and anyone. Too much jealousy, and that's what's driving you. You are being driven by jealousy. That's exactly the state of the church that James was talking to. And remember, these were Christians. He was talking to Christians, people who had accepted Christ. These were the church, you. He was talking to you on YouTube, on Atomgram. The exact kind of people. These are the people that God resists. So he said, submit yourself to God. If you want the devil to leave you alone, if you want the devil to stop messing with your business, because clearly we can see his footprints all over your business, no wonder it's not moving. It's a no-brainer. That's the devil at work in your family. No wonder finances are so hard. The moment you get money, it's slipping through your fingers like this. It's like water. You pour water on your fingers and it's just slipping. Today you get money and there it goes. It just slips through your fingers. It's just gone. It's nowhere to be seen. 1 minute you have a bit of prosperity. You can try to push with your pride. You can try to be overzealous and make a few businesses work. You can try with your pride to make one or two things work in your life. But still, you won't go too far. You are not going far at all. Haven't you seen people who used to be famous and they fell so hard? And then you wonder what happened to them. Pride is what happened. 1 Peter 5:5, quickly. Just go to 1 Peter 5:5. You know, this divine discipline, as I like to call it, when your pastor disciplines you, your woman of God disciplines you, it doesn't feel nice at the time, but trust me, it's the best demonstration of love that you have ever experienced. To find a man who cares about you so much that he can tell you the truth about who you are and the mistakes you're making in your life, God Almighty, that is love. Imagine you are walking around with vegetables in your teeth, green vegetables, and you are walking into a meeting with prime ministers, presidents, and no one tells you. No one, not even one person has enough courage to say, you've got vegetables on your teeth, green vegetables all over. Imagine that. And yet there is one person who says, no, 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 this person, I love them too much. I don't want to see them embarrassed. I don't want to see them crash and burn. So that one person then comes and says, brother, you've had green vegetables on your teeth for the past hour. I don't know how these people haven't been telling you. Someone who can actually say, brother, the way that you are speaking against men of God, this thing is going to hurt you one day. Or sister, the way you address people in church, or the way you conduct yourself in church, or the way that you actually put yourself across, the way you talk to others, your character, the way you are, it really makes people feel uncomfortable. If you have people who can tell you the truth, then that's a good thing. So it's called divine correction. It's okay for divine correction to take place. And even if God brings situations in your life, perhaps you are experiencing an eviction, or somebody is saying you are now evicted, your landlord is saying you are evicted as of next week. And then you say, God, what is this now? And then this happens. God, what is this now? God has allowed these things to happen. He allows them to happen so that you may start thinking, right, I need to go back to my first love. Just like what Prophet has been teaching us the past few weeks, go back to my first love. I need to go back to him. I need to go back to the word, the time that I loved him the most. When I was born again, at first, I couldn't stay without reading my Bible. I wanted to know so much. I was so hungry. Go back to that. That's your first love. Go back to it. Yes, tell me, what are they saying?
Excellent Root on YouTube is saying, we believe so much in spiritual warfare, yet we are not willing to face the devil in us by living according to the word.
Yes.
Pride is like witchcraft.
Yes.
And Prince Angel on Facebook is saying, Mom, this is an atomic bomb. We are too many here untouchables. Tofiakwa, I repent.
On Atom Ram, we've got Vimbai Tower who's saying, you never know you have pride until it's broken down like this. Mom, I repent from pride.
1 Peter 5:5.
Yes, 1 Peter 5:5. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Ye, all of you, be subject one to another and be clothed with humility.
For be God, what?
Be clothed.
Be what?
Be clothed with humility.
And then finish it off.
For God resisteth the proud.
And gives grace to the humble. He repeats again the verse that is in the book of Proverbs. And this is now Peter addressing a whole different crowd. He's saying, listen, guys, if you want things to be good for you, submit, especially you younger ones, submit to your elders. Who is your elder? Submit to that person. And it even says, submit yourselves unto, you younger ones, a bit unto the what? unto the elder, right? Mm-hmm. Submit yourself to the one who is above you. Why can't you just submit? Put yourself under. Resist the devil yourself and put yourself under someone. And then what does he say?
Ye, all of you, be mm-hmm. subject one to another uh-huh. and be clothed with humility.
Be clothed again. It's the same thing. Humility doesn't come naturally. Mm-hmm. You put it on. Be clothed with humility. Mm-hmm.
For God resists the proud mm-hmm. and giveth grace to the humble. Verse 6. Mm-hmm. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God.
You see, it has been repeated over and over and over. It is being repeated over and over. That's how much God wants you to catch this. When you submit, submission itself, it's literally humility itself, because you are putting yourself under. And I like what Prophet says. He says submission is power under control. Yeah. That's what Prophet says. Submitting to someone doesn't mean you're stupid. It doesn't mean you have no power. It doesn't mean you're not clever. It doesn't mean you're not smart. It doesn't mean you don't have a few good points here and there. It doesn't mean that at all. But submission is humility. And if you ever want God to take you somewhere, then you have to learn this. Amen. You must submit yourself. Submit yourself to the authority that is above you. Amen. And ultimately, you're submitting unto God himself. If the word says it, I'll follow it. If God says I should do this, I'm going to follow it. You see, so you can receive as much grace as the humility you possess. So more humility, more grace. Less humility, less grace. It's as simple as that. So if you want to grow in grace, this is the best way to get there. Humble yourself. Put yourself lower than what you actually know. You know yourself. You know I'm clever, I'm smart, I'm this. But you see, to everyone, I'm just humble. I'm just a humble person. You act like you don't know anything. When your mentor says, or your spiritual father, or your pastor, he calls you and says, I wanted to teach you about humility, or I wanted to teach you about faith. Don't say, oh, yes. In fact, I already know. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I even read it just now. Faith is such a... Your pastor hasn't even finished. You are already way ahead of him. Way ahead of the game. Humility says, I know the subject very well. I'm very well versed in this subject. But because I know my level is here, and I know that the Bible says I need to have humility, that means instead of being here where God put me, I'm going to put myself slightly below what I am. I'm going to humble myself. I'm going to act like I don't know anything. Say, oh, teach me, sir. What is it? Tell me. Okay, so that's what faith is. Wow, I'm learning. That's humility. Instead of saying, I know everything. Maybe he's going to tell you an angle or give you a certain kind of revelation that you hadn't caught when you were studying it yourself. But you already shattered every chance of learning anything new. Why? Because your mind is so high. You need to get off your high horse. Somebody said when you have pride, you're sitting on a high horse. Get off the high horse. Put yourself down there. And in some churches, if you're a pastor and you are struggling for people to respect you, maybe it's because you lack humility. You have too much pride. I went to one church one time and people did not like the lady pastor that was there. The pastor's wife, in other words. They didn't like her. Why? Because every time, and this was actually in one of our churches, so I can talk about it because it was a Spirit Embassy church many, many years ago. And thank God it was corrected and it was fixed and everything was fine after that. But I went to this church and it was so hard for people to just get along. And everything was haphazard. And I said, how come this is, there's disorder here, there's disorder there. This is not what we do at the main branch, headquarters. This is not the blueprint the Prophet has given us. And guess what? The people said, you know, the thing is, our pastor is not nice to us. We just have to tell the truth. I wasn't doing the work because obviously it's not good for you not to do God's work just because somebody was bad to you. That's also a bad thing. But still, as a leader, you ought to remove all pride from you. And they said the pastor's wife always tells us, fetch me that run right now while she's sitting. Fetch me this. Said, am I really like an animal? You know, we say fetch to dogs when they need to, when we are playing with them. And that's all she knew how to say. There's no please, there's no thank you, there is no politeness, there is no nothing. Nothing at all. Just you run, fetch, always angry, never smiling. So much pride. Walks into church the very last minute when church is about to begin and is the first one to leave. Imagine that. And people started resisting her to such an extent that it started pouring water on the work of the Spirit that he was doing in that branch. So if you are a leader, be careful that you are not aligning yourself with the devil instead of aligning yourself with what the rest of the army is doing. Go under the command of the commander. Follow the order. Just do whatever is being done there. Follow that order. Put yourself, tuck yourself back in there. Tuck yourself back in there. And God is so gracious because in that scripture, in verse 6, he says, but he gives more grace. Wherefore, he saith, God resists the proud, right? But gives grace unto the humble. And that word humble is talking about somebody who was previously arrogant and then they changed their ways. So this person was getting it wrong. They were getting it twisted. They did have pride, but then they changed and then they submitted to the Lord. And God says, I'll give you more grace. You see, it doesn't say after you confess your sins, after I check my score, what does the scorecard say? You see, let's see. Now they've decided to say, I'm sorry. Okay, let's see. Scorecard, right? They showed pride 15 times last week, so I think let's get a few more stories out of them, at least maybe 5 to 10 more, and maybe 3 days fasting, and then I will say it's okay. No, he says God resists the proud. He resists. Imagine God is so angry that he says the whole army go against that guy. My whole back I have turned against you. I'm going to allow any circumstances, bad circumstances, to happen to you because I resist your pride. But in the exact same sentence, he says But still, I'll give you grace if you are humble. He says, I'll give you the grace. Anything you want, I will give it to you. Because that's grace. Grace, essentially, is receiving everything you need for this life. He says, anything, I'll give it to you. Only if you show that you are humble. Someone who was previously in sin, someone who was previously resisting the Lord, now moves to humility and God blesses them with grace. That's good news. And he is such a gracious God. He doesn't look at any scorecards. He doesn't look at how many times you resisted him. All he knows is the moment you repent, I will give you more grace. Amen. That's amazing. Let me hear what they're saying before we close in a few minutes.
Mandy Pang, it's a question. She's saying, so mm-hmm. Mom, what would be the difference when between humbleness mm-hmm. and confidence? Please explain with an example. As I often
listen,
humble, but many
when
times
people ask whether they whether it's pride or confidence, you already know the difference yourself. Anybody who walks in love knows I have confidence, and this definitely isn't pride. It's confidence. You see, I look at myself. I've often given the example of when I went to I was in Canary Wharf, which happened to be like the financial capital of the United Kingdom. That's where the who's who when it comes to the finance industry is. So I went for a meeting there regarding Brits Money. And I got to the meeting. I was sitting with people who had PhDs and DVDs and whatever other Ds were there. And you know, the first thing they did, were sitting around a table. The first thing they started doing was give each other, you know, exchanging business cards. And they started reading the business card. Wow, what's your PhD? What's yours? And this, you know, they were, I don't know, sometimes men, I'm sure men are really guilty of this more than women. The ego sometimes, they want to be massaged very, very well. So they started massaging each other's egos, exchanging business cards. What's your PhD? Wow. Oh, okay, humanities. What about you? Hey, your PhD. Wow, this one. Whoa, okay. And what about you? And I was sitting there, no PhD to talk about, or DVD. I didn't even have a DVD. I was just sitting there. But guess who was in charge? It was me, because it was my product that I wanted them to do for me. I wanted them to make this product and this software for me. So guess what I told them? I said, right, now that we've got that out of the way, this is what I want you to do for me. Instead of concentrating on these PhDs, I want you to start writing. line by line. I want you to see what it is that your company is going to offer me. And you, I want you to tell me, how will this software, you're talking about this software, how will it work? What are the benefits to my customers? And you, I want you to do this. I was confident, but it wasn't pride. I was confident in who I was in Christ. You see, when you are in Christ, the Holy Spirit is the one who gives you the confidence. And you know that it is Him. In fact, the Bible, I like this scripture that says, I will tell you what to say. Me, myself. That's what God says. He says, when you get to a place, don't worry about what you'll say. Don't worry what will come out of your mouth. I will speak through you. God is not arrogant. God has no pride. He is the epitome of confidence. So you can tell when you walk in love, when you are in Christ, somebody who has no inch of pride in them, you can tell that, no, this is not pride talking. This is confidence. I have Godfidence. So it's not arrogance whatsoever. So you can always tell on which one is which. I want you to go to Luke 14:11. Mm-hmm. We are about to close.
Luke 14:11.
Mm-hmm. What does it say?
It says, for whosoever exalteth himself shall be abased.
Uh-huh. And anyone who exalts himself, you want to put yourself up there? You want to think you are macho beyond the normal levels? You see, I'm not talking about you saying, I am big, Christ is in me, I'm going to do the best for my family, I'm going to do the best for my nation, I'm going to do the best for my city. That's not what I'm talking about. We're talking about pride. Pride, I'm telling you, if you see pride, you will know its DNA is so visible and it's so obvious that this person has pride, because you can't say anything to that person. They are not teachable. It's not confidence at all. It is simply pride. And the Bible says, so whosoever exalts himself, you elevate yourself. No one put you in a certain position. You are the one who put yourself there. No one told you. God didn't tell you. Your man of God didn't tell you. You put yourself there. You shall be lowered. You shall be abased. And what does he go on to say?
And he that humbleth himself.
He that humbles himself shall be exalted. If you humble yourself, God will exalt you. He will lift you up. We used to sing this in creche and nursery and Sunday school. Humble yourself before the Lord. He will lift you up. You need to sing it. He will lift you up. Just be humble enough to know, I submit, I submit, I submit. I submit to God. I hupotasso. No matter what happens, I submit. I lower myself. I put myself under. I wedge myself under. I know this is where I am. I know I'm big, but guess what? I put myself under. Imagine someone who is amazing. You meet this amazing man of God. Someone you love so much. You see them online. They preach to you and they're so amazing. Oh, your favorite woman of God, and they're so amazing. And you meet them one day in the street and then they frown on you. You greet them, hey, how are you? And they frown on you and even spit in your face. What would you think? That's pride in them, right? Something is working in them that is not okay. Something is bad somewhere. Something is wrong. So the Bible says, if you humble yourself, God will lift you up. He will bring you up himself. God will lift you up. Not people. Never mind people. God himself is the one who will do it for you. So he will be abased. You see, you will be abased. And I want you to open one more scripture. Psalm 37. Psalms 37. Please quickly go there.
Yes.
And we want to go to... All right. Psalms 37. Let's go to verse 35.
Psalm 37, verse 35.
Yes, let's go to 35.
I have seen the wicked in great power.
Uh-huh.
And spreading himself like a green bay tree.
Uh-huh. So he's saying, I've seen the wicked in great power. People who are wicked, people who have pride, in other words. You know, this man is wicked, but he's in a position of power. So you start thinking, but this person has so much pride, mom, but how come things are moving for them? I know a guy who started a business and he has so much pride. How come things are moving for him? I know a woman. Oh, that woman has so much pride. The pride is so, you can feel it. It's her aura. It's all over her. But how come things are moving? She's even been promoted to this position. This is your answer. If you know somebody who has pride and they're succeeding and you're a little bit confused that, I thought those who have pride are abased. I thought the ones who have pride are brought down. But how come I know people who are making it in life and they have so much pride? Here's the answer. Read it again. Psalm 37, verse 35.
Mm-hmm. Verse 35. Mm-hmm. I have seen the wicked in great power, mm-hmm. and spreading himself like a green bay tree.
Mm-hmm.
36.
Mm-hmm.
Yet he passed away, and lo, he was not.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Do you see that? I know you didn't catch it. He says, I have seen the wicked in great power. They had power. They had things. They had cars. They had houses. They had recording, contracts. And they had recording deals and sport deals, endorsements. They were being asked to do amazing things. He said, I saw them. I've seen them in great power. And they were spreading like a green bay tree. Everything is moving for them. They're spreading. Everything looks amazing. And then he said, yet he passed away. And lo, he was not. So 1 minute they are there. The next thing, they are gone. He even goes on to say, I sought him. I looked for him. Say, where is the guy who used to live in this nice house? But he could not be found. He was gone. They were reduced. They were abased. So you could be in a great position somewhere. It could be in your church. Maybe you were given a leadership position. You are doing well there. Your wings are spreading. People are respecting you. But there is wickedness in you. And God gave you the position. And he's patient enough to wait. He's patiently waiting on you to change. To change your ways. Patiently waiting. And your wings are spreading like a bay tree. You are even being asked, go to that nation to preach. Now go to this other nation you are preaching. People now know you. You have a program on television. People now know you. People are respecting you. But there is wickedness in you. The Bible here is saying, you will pass away. In other words, the things that you have, they will fall to nothing. They will fall to the ground. We'll say, where was he? Where is he now? Haven't you seen people like that? Some of them were Hollywood A-listers, acting, brilliant acting careers. Where are they now? They were spreading like bay trees, green bay tree. Where are they now? Fallen. They are gone. Pride was in them. What causes that to happen? Pride was found in them. Some of them are even preachers. Once mighty men of God, and then they just fizzle out, and then now nobody even knows where they are. It's like their ministries just vanished into thin air. It could be, I'm not saying it was totally, because God knows, but it could be that in that man of God, pride was found. Pride was found, and it caused him to be abased. There was no lifting up. He was brought down. All right? Jesus himself was the ultimate show of humility. And I'll say this in closing. The ultimate show. What are they saying before we close?
ADFMK Phila is saying, I'm being delivered free for free. No more pride. Thank you, woman of God. Mm-hmm. Now I know how to handle myself. And
awesome.
Christina Good News is saying, thank you, Mom, for this transforming word.
Uh-huh.
It has really helped me to check myself, and I want to grow more in grace.
Mm-hmm.
On Atom Gram, we have Vimbai Tauro, who's saying, this is self-introspection service indeed. It's like a big mirror set before me, and I can clearly see all traces of pride working out my humility right now.
Okay, awesome. Now, I'll say this in closing. The ultimate man, an example of a man, was Jesus Christ. He was the ultimate. The Bible calls us to be Christ-like. Like Christ. That's what we are called to do. Now, let's look at how he demonstrated humility. He was God walking. God walking. Wearing slippers, robes, eating bread in the morning, washing his face like everybody else. What do you call that?
Wow.
He knew this is my position, but this is where I'm choosing to put myself. In fact, he didn't put himself a little lower than where he was. He put himself way, 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 way lower than his actual position of being God, deciding to walk on the planet amongst the creation that he created, looking up at the stars that he created. And yet, what does he do? He comes to this earth, acts like everybody else, humbles himself to that extent. He never walked around saying, right, listen up, everybody. King of Kings and Lord of Lords is here. That's my name. And if you address me as your majesty right now, or you'll be in big trouble because I am actually God. No way. The Bible says he went to his hometown in Nazareth, and then they gave him a Bible to read, and he opened the scriptures. He was given the scriptures, and he was told to read the Bible. This was in Nazareth, in his hometown. He went into a synagogue. This is God, people. We are talking about the Creator. And he holds the Bible, and then he reads the scriptures that he has been given. And when he's finished reading the scriptures, guess what he does? He closes the Bible, gives it back to the attendant, and then he takes a seat. Oh, my God! That is humility 101. Imagine, what? You are God. You are just reading words that are in a Bible. You can even choose not to. You can choose to tell us mysteries that are not even in the Bible, something that is so deep. In fact, you can even throw fire in the air so that people believe you quickly, you know? Do something. Bring some clouds and play with the clouds and form trees with the clouds. Do something so that people can see that you are mighty and they shouldn't play around with you. Do something that proves that you are the mightiest. Imagine God in all his power. He has the power to open up a Red Sea. He has the power to create everything that you can see. The power to do anything and everything. You name it, God can do it. The power to kill people instantly. People died in the Bible for touching the Ark of the Covenant when they were not told to do it. They died instantly. He would put boils on people, or he would say, ground open. And the ground would just open and close. And you'd wonder, where are the people that were standing there gone? Because that would be God acting in anger. He has so much might in him, and yet he's walking like an ordinary man. Reads the Bible. He's even given the verses to read. He says, it is well, I'll read what I'm given. When he's finished, instead of saying, right, just to add to this now, there is another revelation which says this, which is good because he's Jesus. It's okay for him to expand or expound on it or say even more, and read until dawn. No, the Bible says he closed it and he gave it back to the attendant, and he went and took a seat and he sat down. He sat back down, and then the proceedings continued. Ah, you are the God of the synagogue, God of the people in the synagogue, God of everything on this planet, and yet you understand humility like this, submission like this. Do you see what we are saying here? The ultimate man, the man who should demonstrate power more than any of us, understood. This is what submission is. Hupotasso. I will lower myself. I choose to humble myself so that my Father will exalt me. So that God will lift me up. He will exalt me and put me in my rightful position. Not a position I give myself, but the one he has. Look at everything he said. He said, it's not yet my time. It's not yet time. It's not yet time. I'm not going to do it. It's not yet time. I won't do this because it's not yet time. Why? He was following a prescribed order. He wasn't anti-tassoing. He wasn't going against everyone to an extent that God would resist him. He knew that if any pride is seen in me, it's done. The whole operation is done. It's finished. I've messed it up. So no pride was found in him. Why? Because he submitted himself under God. He lowered himself. He put himself under. He never went around shouting, I'm the King of Kings. The crown that they gave him, he didn't look for it himself. They gave him a crown of thorns. Do you think he couldn't afford a crown of gold? With the inscription, I am the real King of Kings. Do you think he couldn't do it if he wanted to? Do you think he couldn't start flying or spinning in the air? If he wanted to, he could do it. He could change stones into anything if he wanted to. He could make animals speak if he wanted to, just to show the kind of power that he had. But guess what? He chose to humble himself, acted like he was nobody. Acted like he had nothing, just did exactly what God sent him to do. The miracles that he was meant to do, just did those enough for people to believe in the God who had sent him. He just did enough. He never went above and beyond saying, now let me add some more. I know I was told today to just pray for people 10 minutes, but let me add a bit more salt and pepper to this prayer. Let's push it to 1 hour. Let's go. As much as you might think, what's wrong with that? Because it's just prayer. No, it's very wrong. If your man of God tells you pray 10 minutes, guess what? It's 10 minutes. You don't go beyond the prescribed order. You don't do that. That's already pride in you. Why? Because you want people to see you. You want people to say, I'm a prayer warrior. People will see me today. I'm the best prayer person in this establishment. And you are sent, can you just pray for those people by your men of God? Pray for this healing line. Instead of healing line, you want now. After this one, deliverance. Anyone, deliverance from smoking. Come. Deliverance from smoking. It's good to deliver people from their smoking habit. It's good to pray for people for whatever habit they have. But were you told to do that? Are you following the prescribed order? Are you under submission? Are you under hupotasso? Or you've already deviated and you are now in the line of pride? Pride can come in so many different ways. Look at the ultimate, Jesus Christ himself. Be Christ-like. Look at what he did. Look at how he conducted himself. And you will know how to conduct yourself. When Jesus arrived at wedding parties, he was just amongst the crowd like everybody else. He didn't want to be seen. He didn't say things to be seen. In fact, he would even tell people after healing them, please don't tell anyone that I've done this. Go, don't tell anyone. And guess what they would do? They would tell everybody. But he was so humble. Such a humble master. Such a humble king. This is what you are called to be. If you want to grow in grace, have humility. Humility that you put on. Humility doesn't just happen. You put it on like you wear a jacket. You take it from the hanger and you put it on. Always remember who you are. Always remember who you are under. Put yourself under all the time. This is your level. Put yourself under. Hupotasso. That's the best way to live. You want to live the best life for God? Then live a submitted life. Are they there?
Yes, Mom, we are here. We have Edwick on YouTube saying, all along I thought I was humble, but Mom, you just made me realize that I just had low self-esteem. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mom. I'm confidently humble from now on.
Exactly. Low self-esteem is just is simply seeing yourself as you are nothing. And the Bible never ever said see yourself as nothing. If anything, God calls and wants children who are confident. God wants children who can stand for themselves. God wants children who can stand for what is right in a world that we are living in. And imagine how these people were living in the times of this time that James is writing to them. They were following the world order. They were following what the world is saying. Oh, the world said we do this. That's what I do. The world says, let's teach sex education, age 5. Yeah, that's good. That's what we do. There's a reason why they're saying it. It's good. Let's do it that way. Everything, they were following the world system. And that's why you will find that in that same scripture, you will see where God was saying, I am now jealous. The Holy Spirit that I placed in you is now jealous because you are now in adultery. He wasn't talking adultery as in the men and women were committing adultery amongst themselves. He was talking about adultery against God. That's what he was saying. He was saying you have committed adultery. Because you are following after the world instead of following after God's system. So that's why now you have provoked God to jealousy. God is now jealous because you are like an adulterous wife that has gone to find somebody else. So when you follow the world, what is the world doing? You are just following. You are just following. There is no confidence in you that says, no, I'm not following this. Remember, you have to stay with the rest of the army. That's antipasso. Remember that. Stay with the rest of the army. When the army is commanded to do something by the commander, you stay with the rest of the army. You don't go in your own direction. When you go in your own direction or in the direction of the world, then that's pride that has already set in. So you never follow the prescription of the world. You go against it. And now more than ever, God is calling his people to this same thing, the same confidence that you say, Christ is in me. And I know what the Bible says about this situation and this situation. I will speak boldly about it. It's not pride. It's God-fidence. So if you know, people who are, I told you, you can feel it. Something in you will tell you, now I think I need to this is a bit too much. I've done this, but I can feel there is a witness. There is a witness in my spirit. There is a witness, and the witness is your spirit. Mm. The witness in my spirit is telling me I did wrong. I need to ask for an apology. I need to apologize. You will always know. Yeah, yeah. Anyone who is in Christ will always know when they have pride, when you've done something and you know, right, that was pride in action. I need to apologize. Yeah. You will know it. The spirit in you will tell you this is wrong and you will know it. So there is a big difference. Low self-esteem is bad. You have to be confident because you are in Christ. Jesus Christ was confident. The things he would say, he would stand before mighty men. And he would speak boldly for what he knew was right. That's confidence. He had no low self-esteem whatsoever. All right.
Maha Shalau is saying, Mom, I'm watching from Kenya. Is it pride maybe to ask the pastor, I'm feeling like preaching, or you must wait until the pastor...
That's a very high level of pride. You can never, ever ask your man of God, I feel like preaching, give me a slot or give me a bit of time to just showcase my abilities. I just need a time slot, my own slot. What is that? It is pride. I forgot what the name of the person. It is pride. And thank you so much for asking the question. It is. You can never go to your pastor and say, I'm called to be a pastor as well, so can I preach in your church? What you are essentially saying is you do not hear from God, because if you heard from God, you would know that I'm a pastor. That's what you are saying. I'm translating what you are saying when you ask your pastor that. You don't hear from God that I am called to preach. So I am putting myself forward. Here I am. Use me to preach in your church. Never make that mistake. Any person who has asked to preach in our church, we have resisted them. We go against them. We don't want to hear. That's the biggest red flag anyone can ever bring forth in a church. Or say, I'm called to be a prophet as well. So I was just wondering, can you mentor me? You are in our church. You want me to mentor you? How many prophets? And you should never mistake the gift of prophecy and the office of a prophet. You see, because that one, a lot of you make a lot of mistakes when it comes to these gifts of the Spirit. You have the gift of prophecy. You say something to someone and it happens. That doesn't make you a prophet. You say something and it happens, that doesn't make you a prophet. You declare something in your life, it happens, that doesn't make you a prophet. Yeah. So a lot of people then come and say, so I am a prophet as well, just so you know, I'm a prophet as well, but can you just tell me, what is God saying about my visa? And then I will turn around and say, you know when God was telling you you're a prophet? Next time he comes, ask him during that conversation, ask him about your visa too then. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. Always wait, that's order. Be a disciple. These guys that Jesus was walking around with, they were disciples first before they were apostles. They were disciples moving around with Jesus, serving him, giving him food to eat, helping to control the crowd. And then when the time came, they were traveling all over the world, preaching to everybody. Start down there. Serve in your church. Sweep the church, clean the toilets, do all the things. We have one of our pastors we were talking about the other day, Pastor Felix in Zim. We were talking about him with Prophet the other day. He started as just one of the security guys at church. He's just there as part of the protocol, just security at the church, just moving around. You're just guarding everyone, making sure everybody's safe. And now he's part of the CEC. He's in the Central Executive Committee. Imagine. From the grassroots, from protocol. That's amazing. That's a clear example of somebody that God has exalted. So humble yourself. Don't go around asking for positions in your church. Give your man of God time. Let him hear from God himself. Don't be impatient to preach. And why must you want to preach at the same pulpit? Preach in the streets. Preach in the supermarkets. Preach in the hospitals. Don't preach in church because the preacher is already there. Go out into the world. Jesus didn't say go out into the churches. Go into the world. Amen. Easy. All right. So I want you to remember, clothe yourself with humility. Mm-hmm. Clothing yourself with humility simply means you are bringing yourself to subjection. You are submitting under God. And when you do that, you become invincible. You become invincible. Amen. the devil will flee only if you submit yourself to the Lord. You want to grow in more grace? Then humility should be your biggest friend. I like a saying that says, take a piece of humble pie. Go to your refrigerator. Find yourself an invisible pie that is called humility. Cut yourself a big piece of it and consume it. Consume it very well, that humility. Be humble. Eat that humility. Live that humility. Put it on. When you finish showering in the morning, you put on your clothes. I want you to actually say this to yourself. Thank you, Lord, for this day. I take my humility jacket and I wear it right now. Before I even start my day, put your humility on. It's so attractive. In relationships, it's attractive. In church, it's attractive. The people we are attracted to the most in churches are people that are humble. As pastors, we are always on the lookout for humility more than anything in people that we want to work with. It's very attractive to the Lord. And he says, I'll give you more grace. If you just show me humility, if you just hupotasso, submit yourself to me, then the gates are wide open for you. And I just love you so much. And I want to thank our amazing man of God, Prophet Angel. He's the one who said I should tell this to you guys. He's the one who said we should talk about hupotasso today. Therefore, it means this is a word in due season for you. This is a word that God wants you to know today. So you are blessed to know God's mind for you today, May 2020. This is exactly what God wants you to know. It's a time of spiritual growth. We are growing exponentially. By the time this lockout is done, we are giants in the realm of the spirit. We are untouchable. Victory is yours if you understand humility. Excellence is yours if you understand humility. Dominion is yours if you understand humility. If you understand hupotasso, all these things are yours. And this, brothers and sisters, is how to live the best life for God. I'm not out of good news. I'm simply out of time. And we love you. See you tomorrow. Prophet will be here and he will be exploding some things here. So watch out for that. See you guys tomorrow. Love you. Bye for now.